Hi, it's Pastor Jim coming to you with words of hope and encouragement today. We are recording this video on Tuesday, March the 2nd. It's hard to believe that it has been 4 weeks since I last recorded one of these videos, and it feels good to be back. My recovery from back surgery is going well. The doctor told me he could alleviate 75 to 90% of my pain, and so far he seems to have successfully reached the high end of that estimate, so I'm very thankful. I will see the surgeon for a follow-up visit on March 22nd. Until then, I'm still kind of limited in some of the things I can do. I can't sit for long periods of time, and I'm not supposed to twist my lower back or bend over to pick things up, which is why I have this very cool reacher grabber device. And in addition to being able to pick up things that I drop, I can also play with the dog with this when Mary brings her dog over, and I can annoy Holly from time to time, which she really appreciates. But you notice the candle that is burning here to my right. It's the same candle that we lit back in one of the worship services in January, and it's been burning in each of the services since then and also in these videos. But before I get to retiring the candle, I want to say a few things about what I focused on in worship 2 weeks ago in the message I preached titled, The Temptation of Jesus and Ours. Jesus being tempted by Satan is written about in the 4th chapter of Matthew, verses 1 to 11, and also in the Gospel of Luke, chapter 4, verses 1 to 13. Now, I'm not going to rehash everything that I said in that message. It is available on Friedberg's YouTube page if you're interested in seeing that. But I do want to read a passage of Scripture and then mention again the titles of some of the books that I suggested that you read. But first, let's take a look at the Scripture here. It's in Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 20. And the Apostle Paul is writing, and he says this, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes." And this is the part that's really important for us to remember. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood. In the midst of all that is going on in our world, all of the kind of the craziness that we see, it is easy for us to focus our attention and sometimes our angst and our irritation at other people. And what we tend to do is demonize other people. We are not to be doing that. We are to oppose demons, not demonize our opponents. So there may be people with whom we disagree theologically, there may be people with whom we disagree socially, but they are not our real enemy. In fact, a few days ago, I was reading an investment newsletter, of all places to read something like this, and he was using the illustration that if you take a large jar, and inside the jar you have normal black ants, and then you have some fire ants in there as well, as long as you leave them alone, they will be pretty calm in one another's presence. But if you shake that jar, they will fight one another to the death. And the thing that he said, I thought it was very profound, is we need to figure out who it is that's shaking our jar. Because it's pretty clear to me that there are forces at work that are setting groups of people up against one another. And if we fall into the pattern of seeing other people as our enemies, seeing other people and demonizing them, we're going to be playing right into the nefarious plot that is going on behind the scenes. And that's kind of what Paul is talking about here. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the authorities, the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. And then he goes on to say, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you will be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. And then he goes on to describe the full armor of God, which I'm not going to take the time to read about all of that here, but he ends up by saying this, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions, with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints. And that's what I encourage you to do. I want to encourage you to be people of prayer and to help you become wiser and more discerning in regard to Satan and his schemes. I did recommend a couple weeks ago in that message, and I'm going to state those titles of those books again and encourage you to read them so you can be more discerning and more wise in regard to the schemes of our true enemy. But also, just focus in on the need to pray, and I'll say more about that in a few moments too. One of the first books that I mentioned in that sermon is a title that was written by C.S. Lewis long time ago. It's probably about 75 years old now. He wrote it during World War II, and then it was published shortly after the war was done, and that is called The Screwtape Letters. And you can find that on Amazon or in a local bookseller if you are able to go to Barnes & Noble or another place like that. And I would encourage you to read that. Screwtape is a senior demon, and the gist of the book is it's letters written between Screwtape, who is a senior demon, to his nephew Screwtape, who is a junior demon. And he is counseling Wormwood on how to go about working his plan in the life of his patient, the man to whom he is assigned. So that was the first of the books. A second one is a more modern picking up on the Screwtape Letters. It was written just last year by a fellow whose name is Benson, Roderick Benson. The title is The Wormwood Deceptions. And the idea is that Wormwood is now advanced in the ranks of demons, and rather than deal with people individually, he is now looking at things on a larger scale. And so you also get to see what's going on in the life of a young man and young woman as they are being encouraged to turn from the path that God would have them to follow. So that's The Wormwood Deceptions. And then the third one is titled A Nefarious Plot, and that's written by a man whose name is Steve Dace. And Nefarious is a senior demon who is, in a sense, is writing after the fact and sort of bragging on what it was he did to bring down the United States of America. So that's also another book that I would recommend to you. One that I do have in front of me is a novel that was written many years ago in the mid-1980s by a man whose name is Frank Peretti, and it's titled This Present Darkness. And again, it's fictional, but it looks at a town called Ashton, and you get a glimpse sort of behind the veil of what is going on demonically there and how God's people praying has such a profound effect on the angelic armies as they oppose Satan and his schemes in the town of Ashton. And I guarantee you, if you read this book, you will never look at prayer and spiritual warfare in the same way again. So I would recommend that. And lastly, I would say to you, if you are a parent, I would recommend C.S. Lewis's books, The Chronicles of Narnia. If your child is a young reader, just you might want to spend time reading the book with them and talking about it. What I'm holding in front of me is actually a radio theater version of those chronicles that it was done by a ministry called Focus on the Family that I would recommend to you. They do a really good job with that. And the books are, if you've seen the movies, the books are much, much better than the movies themselves. As I mentioned earlier, I want you to remember the call to be people of prayer. As it says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18, pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. And that is how we engage in spiritual warfare most effectively. I encourage you to be a person of prayer. I encourage you also to come and worship with us on Sunday morning. We are open for in-person worship at 8:30 in the Family Life Center or at 11 o'clock here in the sanctuary. We do take appropriate COVID-19 precautions at both of those services, but if you live at a distance or you're just not yet comfortable with coming and attending in-person worship, you can always tune in to the live stream of our 11 a.m. service which there's a link to that on our Friedberg.Church website, or you can go directly to Friedberg's YouTube channel. Now, as I mentioned earlier, we're going to be retiring this candle today. We've been burning this for the past several weeks. For those of you who don't know the story, when I moved upstairs into the main office, I found this box, which had been stuck away in a closet for many years. And when I opened it, I found inside a large beeswax candle. Now, not knowing what to do with it, I just put the candle back inside and sort of stuck that behind some books that were on a shelf in my office. And I rediscovered it looking around for some stuff. I found that, rediscovered it shortly after this past Christmas, and a thought popped into my head. How sad that this candle, which had been created to shine brightly in services of worship, giving glory to Jesus, the one who is the light of the world. That's the purpose for which it had been created, yet it had never been able to fulfill that purpose. So I decided that I would light it during a sermon, and if you saw that back in January, I included that as part of the message. And so we let it burn to the glory of God, and we have been burning it each Sunday since then, and in the videos that I've done since then, we've had it burning. But as you can see, it's sort of getting down to the end of things here. It has been consumed in fulfilling its purpose, consumed in burning to the glory of God. So what we're going to do is, after today, I'm going to retire it, and then what's remaining of this candle will be returned to the candle makers, and its remaining wax will be melted down along with the wax of other candles, and it will be used to make new candles, which also will be able to burn and shine brightly to God's glory, reminding all who see them that Jesus is the light of the world. Now, for me, as I was thinking about this, I see in this candle a metaphor of my life and the lives of all of us who follow Jesus. We are created to shine warm and bright with the love and truth of our Savior. And we will never fulfill the purpose for our lives with our light hidden away somewhere. We're to burn and shine for Jesus. We're to get out there and shine for Him. And over the course of our lives, to be consumed in the burning. And then to leave behind a legacy of faith in the lives of other people that we have touched and blessed in godly ways, so that they too will shine with the love and truth of the Savior that we love. And so my hope for me is that is what my life has done, that is what my life is doing, and will continue to do for years to come until the day the Lord calls me home. And whenever that is, I hope that it can be said of me that He shined with the light of Jesus. And that takes us back to words that Jesus Himself spoke. We find them in the 5th chapter of Matthew, verses 14 to 16, where He says to His disciples, and through them He says to us, "You are the light of the world. A city that is built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and then it can give light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Remember the song we learned as children, "This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine." Brothers and sisters, remember always, we are blessed to be a blessing. So let's get out there and be a blessing. Let us shine for Jesus wherever we go.